referred to Dr. S. Ajit, President FOCSI 2020, for the topic of quality patient care in labor and delivery, a call to action during NOASIS 20, held 12 September 2021 on virtual reality platform. By bestowing this oration on him, we acknowledge not only his continued contribution to the field of obstetric and gynecology, but also for being beacon of light for members of varied generation to explore, comprehend, and dedicate the discoveries for overall patient care. Wishing him many more years of academic excellence, dated this, the 12th day of September 2021, Dr. Kunjumedin, chairperson of chairman of organizing committee of 20, and president of POCS, Dr. Abdul Wahab, secretary POCS.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dr.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr.
Over to Dr.
Thank you, Dr. Wahab, Dr. Kunjumedin, Dr. Mitra Saxena. Let me share my screen. It is my privilege to present this topic, the quality patient care in labor and delivery, a call to action. As the KFOG president, when we discuss about quality care, all pregnant women should receive evidence-based, equitable, compassionate, and respectful care throughout labor and childbirth. But there are a lot of unnecessary labor interventions, especially in the latent phase of labor, unnecessary amniotomy, unnecessary oxytocin augmentation, ineffective and potentially harmful labor practices like starting oxytocin immediately after doing amniotomy, giving antispasmodics in active labor, and there are failure to employ effective labor involved interventions. Sometimes where we had to do a cesarean section, we failed to do it. More than that, there is non-dignified and abusive care, mistreatment. All over the world, it is happening, the mistreatment to the laboring women. We all know the statement of past president of FIGO, women are not dying because of the lack of facilities or the lack of, we cannot treat them. They are dying because of society have to yet to make decision regarding their lives are worth saving. Two important parameters of quality care are maternal mortality ratio and the neonatal mortality rate. If you take India, as per the SRS report of 2016-2018, the maternal mortality ratio is 113 per 1 lakh childbirth. There is wide variation, you can see, from 43 in Kerala to 215 in Assam. In Kerala, as per the last year, we could reduce it to 29. The Kerala government and the KFOG has set a target of 30 by 2020. So we could reach it. But this time, because of the COVID, again, there may be rise in the maternal mortality ratio. So this wide variation of maternal mortality ratio, especially in the northern states. Similarly, the neonatal mortality rate per 1,000 live births, again, if you take the whole India, it is 26. Starting from 6 in Kerala to 36 in Odisha. So that is the importance of doing the audit. In Kerala, from 2004, we are doing the confidential review of maternal death under the leadership of Elisa. And for the last 6 years, we are doing the near miss audit also. The last 2 years, we started the district wise auditing of the all the near miss and the maternal death that the MD NMS are. Just the audit is not sufficient. The findings from the audit, we have to implement it. Again, in Kerala, the reduction in the maternal mortality rate is one reason is the implementation of this the findings through IMOCAN of the doctors, the emergency obstetric care treatment, the training of nurses and doctors. The KFOG has put some quality standards, and still there are a few deaths which can be prevented if there is a rapid response. So each hospital should have a obstetric rapid response team. So if you take the last 10 years maternal death in Kerala, the leading causes are PPH, still it is PPH, then hypertension, sepsis. But the last year, the viral infections and the suicide were the leading causes. So we had to find out the reason, and then we had to implement how we can reduce this. So especially the PPS is very important, the quality standards to try and prevent PPS or the active management of their safe labor. Throughout Kerala, it is standardized. Oxytocin IV bolus, 5 units or 5 seconds, plus oxytocin 10 units intramuscularly at the time of delivery, immediately after delivery of the baby. The 4-stage management, the golden hour. Especially, you have to palpate the uterus and make sure that the uterus is contracting, and in between, you have to look for the bleeding. And if the blood transfusion is needed, blood has to be given, especially if if there is a change in the vitals and the fluid management is not picking up, not correcting the vitals, it comes to giving blood transfusion. And if the blood transfusion is needed, such patients has to be observed in the HTU. And another very important point is a dedicated ultrasound at 32 weeks, not previous cesarean section, because apnea is contributing to the morbidity and mortality. What are the quality standards in hypertension? These are the 5 points KFOG has put forward. BP checkup and urine protein testing in antenatal visits, especially in the third trimester. And starting antihypertensive therapy when the BP is persisting more than 140/90. Parenteral antihypertensive, BP is more than 160/110. And in all patients with a hypertension, the liver enzymes and the platelet has to be monitored. You have to do this to rule out HELLP syndrome. In patients with impending eclampsia, severe preeclampsia, and eclampsia, use magnesium sulfate, again, the standard dose. Again, about the sepsis, these are the quality standards put forward by the KFOG. A dedicated sterile vaginal examination sets for all vaginal examination. Dedicated autoclave delivery sets. In delivery room, there should be a clean running water with appropriate taps, preferably an elbow-operated tap. There should be written down antibiotic policy. The MUSE chart, the modified early warning sign chart, in all cases, especially after delivery and cesarean section. So that has MUSE chart has to replace the conventional, the usual temperature chart. And if sepsis is diagnosed, appropriate care bundle has to be started, and the multidisciplinary team should be involved, and if necessary, has to be transmitted to the appropriate senders. Recognize this importance of this, the government of India, the Ministry of Health, on 11th December 2017 introduced this Lakshya program with the objective of reducing the maternal and newborn morbidity and mortality, improving the quality of care during delivery and immediate postpartum period, and enhance satisfaction of beneficiaries, the positive birth experience, and the respectful maternity care to all pregnant women attending public health facilities. The WHO also recognized it, and they put forward this concept of positive childbirth experience during the pregnancy in 2016, and even they they came out with a guideline regarding the intrapartum care in 2018. And the conventional parthogram should be replaced by the WHO labor care guide, because the conventional parthogram still, the labor progress is mentioned is 1 centimeter per hour in the active phase. And the active phase starts at 3 centimeter. So this has to be changed to the WHO labor care guide. So this is the new WHO labor care guide, where you can see 7 sections. And here, the section 2 and section 7 are very, very important. Section 2 is regarding the supportive care, how much support we are giving to the patient. And the section 7 is regarding in the decision making, are we involving the patient and relatives? So in addition, so that is a positive childbirth experience. It guides monitoring and documentation of well-being of women and babies and progress of labor, and guide the healthcare personnel to offer supportive care throughout the labor to ensure a positive childbirth experience. So the conventional parthogram has to be replaced by the WHO labor care guide for a positive childbirth experience. Delivery of healthy baby in a clinically and psychologically safe environment. Continuous emotional support from the birth companion and technically competent clinical staff. Involvement in decision making even when medical interventions are needed. So sometimes if you have to do a cesarean section, just involve the patient in the decision making. So this gives a positive childbirth experience. So the guiding principles of intrapartum care are labor and childbirth should be individualized and should be woman and baby centered. No intervention should be implemented without a clear medical indication, because it may be harmful, like giving antispasmodic inactive labor or doing amniotomy or oxytocin in the latent phase. Another very important thing is the severe pain is the labor pain. So you have to consider the labor pain and adequate labor analgesia, epidural or the opioid or even the non-pharmacological approach. So labor analgesia is very important. So we need to have a comprehensive approach with the woman and baby in the center. There should be a continuity of care, respectful labor and childbirth care, emotional support from a companion of choice, effective communication by the staff, pain relief, regular labor monitoring, documentation of events, audit and feedback, oral fluids and food intake, mobility in the labor and birth position of choice. So try to avoid the supine position. And there should be a pre-established referral plan. So a comprehensive approach is very important, because we all know that the companionship loop during labor reduces the cesarean section rate. But if you are still going through that, the Friedman's curve, that is the old parthogram, that is 1 centimeter, we are expecting 1 centimeter dilatation after in the active phase, then the cesarean section rate may not decrease. So you should have a comprehensive, so everything you have to consider together, and we should have a woman and baby centered approach. The labor companion, we all know that it reduces the cesarean section, reduces the negative rating of birth experience. Then coming to the some of the common practices like continuous electronic fetal monitoring, there is no evidence that it has to be given in all low-risk women, but practically speaking, all patients are monitored, especially the high-risk patients and induced patients. All these things are monitored with the continuous electronic fetal monitoring, and whether it is rising the cesarean section rate. But if there should be a regular updating of skills is needed, we need to train the health personnel regarding how to read the CTG, and periodic reviews are needed. Sometimes at least every. Sometimes it may be harmful to use the continuous electronic fetal monitoring, at least in the low-risk women. What is the future of fetal monitoring? Interpretation of fetal heart rate tracing with the use of artificial intelligence, even we have to consider the clinical situation. Then, if we have such automated systems, it may be more useful. And it should be in such a way that it should allow mobility of the patient. And I don't have to say a lot about the Robson's classification, because Dr. Robson itself highlighted us the importance of, definitely the cesarean section rate is an indicator of quality of intraparenteral care. So we have to look into it. We should be prepared for complications. We have to anticipate it, and we have to sometimes unanticipated complication occurs. So we have to prepare for that. Sometimes during delivery of a mobile herd, if a forceps or a vacuum is not available, windows is not available, or if we are not properly trained in doing it, so we should be prepared for delivery of a mobile herd at cesarean section. Similarly, delivery of a deeply engaged herd at cesarean section. We have to, if there is a shoulder dystocia, what to do? We should have a plan on it. PPH. So there should be a preparedness for PPH, hypertensive emergencies, amniotic fluid embolism. Again, even though it's mentioned as unpredictable, untreatable, all these things, if we have a rapid response team there, we can do it. We can do something. Yeah? We know more it is can be considered as untreatable. We can save some of the lives. The role of resuscitative hysterectomy, previously we used to call it a perimortem cesarean section. So that, again, preparedness for that also has to be there. Instrumented delivery, if there is a failure, what to do? And we heard about intrapartum ultrasound, the role of intrapartum ultrasound. And there should be some method to how to break a bad news. Even though we do everything, sometimes stillbirth can occur, or sometimes unwanted things can occur in labor room. So how we should break that bad news to the patient's relatives? So we should be prepared for all these things. And there should be definite protocols, especially regarding the antibody policy, DVT prophylaxis, and the blood transfusion. As far as possible, avoid single blood transfusion. And if it is a massive blood transfusion, again, how to go for that? So we should have a policy on it. Again, as far as possible, avoid all blood transfusion, go for competent therapy. These are some of the practices not recommended. Routine clinical pelvimetry, especially before the labor, because we all know that the fetal head is the best pelvimeter. So doing a routine clinical pelvimetry and saying that there is EPD and taking cesarean section is no more right. It is not recommended. Routine oral or nasal suction of babies at vaginal delivery or cesarean section. Routine antibiotics after uncomplicated deliveries. Use of cervical dilatation threshold of 1 cm per hour for assessment of normal labor progression. Interventions to accelerate labor before 5 cm of dilatation, early amniotomy and early oxytocin, use of antispasmodics. Some of the practices that are recommended are encouraged mobility and oral hydration. Active phase starts at 5 cm, and no more it is 1 centimeter per hour. It continues for up to 12 hours in a primary and 10 hours in a multi. Duration of second stage can be up to 3 hours in a primary and 2 hours in a multi. Active management of third stage labor, again, it should be standardized. Delayed cord clamping, unless baby need to be resuscitated early. Controlled cord traction, skin-to-skin contact with the and breastfeeding, and the monitoring the fourth stage, the first 2 hours, and delayed newborn bathing. These are some of the practices that are recommended. So to conclude, respectful maternity care is very important, and practices of mistreatment of women in labor has to be avoided. Avoid routine use of ineffective and potentially harmful practices. And we should have a comprehensive approach, involve the women in the decision making. Thank you very much.